for a long time.
You be on the cultivator, I'll be on the plow. You bring that field right back up after I turn it down. If it don't rain by Friday, we'll have it in the ground. On Saturday, I'll take you into town. That old Avery, it don't run no good at all. It makes it up the hill. Then at the top it stalls. The man who sold it to me, I give him a call. His widow says he lives in Montreal. You be on the cultivator, I'll be on the plow. You bring that feed right back up after I turn it down. If it don't rain by Friday, we'll have it in the ground. On Saturday I'll take you into town. We won't need no gasoline, I can catch that mule.
We won't need no gasoline, I can catch that mule.
Grind that oats to oatmeal, feed those kids on gruel. We won't send them to no stinking school.
You be on the cultivator, I'll be on the plow. You bring that feed right back up after I turn it down. If it don't rain by Friday, we'll have it in the ground.
On Saturday, I'll take you into town. On Saturday, I'll take you into town.
I was living on a farm, and I had living in on a little farm with eight brothers and sisters in Caser Center, Ontario, Lincoln County, Ontario, Canada. And I was working hard like a man when I was a little kid. I was 10 or 12 years old, and I came in from outside. It was cold. I'd been working in the barn, working cattle, and freezing. I came in to warm up, and we just got a television, and Elvis was on television, and it was Elvis in Hawaii, and I went, wow, he's got girls, he's happy, he's warm, and I'm just going to do that. I thought he wrote his own song, so I went upstairs that night, started writing songs, quit doing all my schoolwork. I never did schoolwork after that. I never passed a grade for real, and that was fifth or sixth grade, and that was it. And that was it. That's what I did. I'd spent the next 10 years writing songs, 3 or 4 a day, so I just wrote and wrote and learned to do it. And so I was writing songs organically, like I was going, I think it should do this here. And I would do it. And later on, I found out that that was a bridge. But I didn't know you wrote the bridge. I wrote the bridge because it sounded right. So it was cool. I did it all backwards. But by the time I was 23, when I did my first album, I had already had 10 years of songwriting experience. Mary Gauthier, Miranda Lambert, Alan Jackson, Toby Keith, lots of movies. I've had like 100 different songwriters, singers cover my songs. There's been like 100 covers over the years of different, you know, of different levels of professionalism. But yeah, and then there's a whole bunch way underneath. People sing my songs. It's nice. I keep writing about this truck driver. I've been writing about him for years and years. And I started writing about him when I was a kid. And it's always, as I get older, the trucker sort of gets in a different situation. So when I started, he was just, you know, I got 13 gears in my eyes filled with tears. And that's how it started when I was 18 or 19 years old. And I just kept writing him in these songs. And then in the 90s, I wrote a big song called Water and the Fuel, which is related to trucker speed. And then in 2006 or 5, whenever it was, I thought, what's he doing now? And he was just a mess. And so I just wrote him. He was just a mess. You know, it was funny, but it was like 10 years later, he was in trouble. And I wrote it in 5 or 10 minutes, you know. I didn't think much about it, you know. But I'd had all those sort of pills and drugs in my head about all the, I watch them all the time at the truck stops. I always see what kind of drugs the truckers are taking, you know. You know, stackers and all that stuff. So it was sort of cool. I could put them all in a song, and it was real. You know, truckers. I have a huge following in that world, not like a normal following, but guys say, you know, I don't listen to your music all the time, but it's the one about, you know, people don't like to listen too much about their life, but I have all these, you know, they like that it's real.
Got her a letter in a little mailbox I forgot I had at an old truck stop. I read it once and then I read it again. I can hardly keep from crying. I've been driving around the last week or so with an empty truck. I don't have a load. And I don't care, cause to tell you the truth, I think I might be dying. And it's trucker speed, Benzedrine, Percocets, amphetamine, Black Beauties and West Coast turnaround. When the coast is clear, I drive with my knees, mix it all up in a recipe, Coca-Cola and coffee to wash it down. Sometimes I feel like my wheels ain't touching. By the side of the road, he said, you're a mess. When I told him, she didn't even leave an address. Then he got another call, he said, wait right here, I'll be back in a little while. I put my head across my hand, slept over the wheel for an hour or more. Then I started up and I took off into the speed, Benzedrine, Percocets, amphetamine, Black Beauties and West Coast turnaround. When the coast is clear, I drive with my knees, mix it all up in a recipe, Coca-Cola and coffee to wash it down. Sometimes I feel like my wheels ain't touching. Sometimes I feel like my wheels ain't touching the ground. I've been high-centered and low-throttled when I couldn't stop. I peed in a bottle. I've been so lonesome, made Hank Williams look like a party of five. I've been beat up, broke down, loaded on a truck and driven into town. But I always thought you'd be there at the end of the line. Always thought she'd be there at the end of the line.
Benzedrine, Percocets, amphetamines, Black Beauties and West Coast turn around. Oh, and the coast is clear or dry with my knees, mix it all up in a recipe. Coca-Cola and coffee to wash it down. Sometimes I feel like my wheels ain't touching the ground. Sometimes I feel like my wheels ain't touching the ground. Sometimes I feel like my wheels ain't touching.
And there's another one called 18 Wheels, which is a big song for me. Yeah, all the, this guy is always this guy who's just like down the road. And it might be his cousin, but it's always in this little family of truckers that I like to write about. And it's a weird thing. People say, well, you've just rewritten the song. And really, in a way, I have. I don't care. Because somebody might hear Trucker Speed and never have heard Water in the Fuel, and it will touch them in a different way than Water in the Fuel touched my fans in the 90s. You know, so some guy comes up to me and says, Trucker Speed, best song I ever heard. Never heard of Water in the Fuel. Or you know, guys say, Water in the Fuel. I haven't listened to anything since. And that's the thing about having a big career. And you're always supposed to just, there's a whole bunch of rules that I don't follow in this world in that regard. The most controversial song is probably the song that, it's the buzz of the day. So in the 80s, when the feminist movement was going on, I would get hassled about these songs. They would call them misogynist. And in the 90s, the women were the first ones standing on their feet applauding these songs I had written about strong women that in the 80s they called misogynist. In the 90s, they called them like pro-feminist. In 2000s, they don't care. And so I'm out, you know, I remember when I wrote the song Time to Get a Gun that Miranda, you know, I remember in the 90s opening for a woman who gave me trouble about it. I was just going, well, it just happened. That's all. That's what happened. It actually happened. That very song is true right to the thing. You know, somebody stole my neighbor's car and I thought, geez, man. And I thought, that's an interesting thought. Should I get a gun? I thought it was, I didn't get a gun, but I thought, that's an interesting thought. Should I get a gun? I thought that's a good thing to write. I like to write about songs that don't really have the answer. It's like, what is it? You know, and so many people got on the wrong side of that song on both sides of the political spectrum. They got on the wrong side. Some people think it's irony, and some people think it's real. Some people think I'm really a gun guy. They show up at the show thinking that I'm an NRA guy, and some guys think that I'm just Mr. Ironic, and really all I did was wrote about what happened to me. My neighbor's car got stolen, and I was walking around the farm, and my wife at the time actually said, maybe we should start locking the door. The neighbor's car got stolen. I just reported. And many times I'm reporting, and people think I'm more clever than I am, but I'm just really recording the facts. I write songs every day almost, you know. I write songs all the time. I write a verse or a song or a lick or a line, but, you know, I have a warehouse full of songs. So I revisit them, and I have books at home. I have a box this high full of songs that I haven't looked at in 10 years. And I just have all these songs, and I write them wherever I am. Doesn't matter. I know there's a song called Rough Edges that I know I wrote it for 10 years. I know I finished it after 10 years. I wrote it and wrote it. And, you know, there's songs I'm working on still to this day that I started when I was 20 years old, and I never really got it. And then sometimes I get it, and sometimes I still haven't got it. Usually you're just trying to unlock the box. It's a treasure, and all you're trying to do is pick the lock or find the combination. And when I find the combination, I open it up, and there's this beautiful song, and I go, there it was, dumbass, all the time. It's mostly me standing in the way of a song that wants to come up into the world, into the universe. It's really not mine. I'm just unlocking the box.
Texas border, traffic was stopped at a railway crossing, took it to the shoulder. I stoked the kettle, I put it to the metal, I shook the gravel loose. I missed the train, but I was happy with a glimpse of the caboose, 'cause I like trains.
You know, I travel all the time. You know, I'm on the road all the time. So it's not necessarily what you see when you travel. It's how you feel. When traveling, you feel more than you see. You see, but you go, oh, it's raining. This reminds me of another time. Or this gives me a certain feeling. Oh, look, there's mist on that field. That reminds me of this. You're not always present when you're traveling, which is sort of the cool thing about traveling, even though you have to live in the moment, because every move is a move. You're not just having coffee at the dinner table. Even if you're having the coffee in the Starbucks, there's people coming in, there's people leaving. It's like you're always like assessing the moment. So you're living in the moment, but and this is so anti-Zen or anti, but really, you're riding on thoughts, sort of you're riding on this feeling you have. I could write songs all day. I mean, what people I write with, you know, I have this weird, I'm fortunate. I have this weird, almost an idiot, you know, I could just write songs. I write them on stage when I'm on stage. I do every night. I write songs on stage. I sing them for people. You know, it's just some weird thing that's happened to me. You know, it's just so weird. I guess it's because I'm 60 years old and I've been writing songs for at least almost 50 years, like every day. It's crazy. I don't work with any songwriters right now because I'm on the road and I sort of went to Nashville in the 90s. I needed to make a deal. I was starving. And I learned a whole bunch of things about how to write songs and how not to write songs. And I really learned beautiful, beautiful things. They craft, you know. They craft so well. They're not always emotionally in touch, those great songwriters down there, but they craft. And it was really good for me to have to learn this discipline of crafting. And then I threw it all out the window, but I know how to do it. Well, on this tour here, I haven't really taken any significant time off. I always say I left on this tour in 1996, which is 21 years that this tour has been, because really I haven't had any significant time off, any time more than a month off in those 26 years, you know. And I'm talking about a month every 3 years, maybe, or 2 years. You know? So it's been a little nuts, you know, it's been a little nuts. You know, the biggest thing, I have some PTSD issues from when I was a kid, so I don't remember a lot. But people remind me of things I did, you know, and somebody says, you know, there was cops pulled over this drunk guy at this festival in there, and he was being belligerent, and you jumped the fence and grabbed him and said, look, just cool out, or they're going to arrest you and leave your boy. You know, they're going to take your boy away because they had a five-year-old. I don't remember anything. But people tell me, remind me that I did good things and that people put my music on when they die. You know, they do this a lot. A woman called me one time and said, would you call my brother? He's dying this week. Can you call him? And I called him. And he said, his name was Larry. And he said, it's Larry. I said, I'm Fred Eaglesmith. Your sister asked me to call you. And he says, I'm going over today, man. I'm going over to the other side today, brother. I'm listening to your music. Like, holy cow, you know. I just write some weird songs about trains, you know. And this is really the biggest thing. If I can help. You know, if I can help somebody go through their death or go through a bad time, or a guy told me one time he had made an appointment to commit suicide. A kid told me this in Northern Canada. He said, I was going to commit suicide. And as I was about ready to kill myself, he said, your song came on the radio. And I was so intrigued by the song. I listened to the song and he said, and I realized I hadn't killed myself after the song. And I thought, well, I'm just going to go listen to some more of his songs. And his mother was crying. He was telling me, and I was just like, this really doesn't have anything to do with me, but what a nice thing. What a nice thing, you know. Alcohol and pills, you know. But what a nice thing. These are things I did not intend to. And, you know, it's not like I'm some new age guru type, you know, man bun artist, right? This is cool, you know. It's really nice for me that this happens. So you go, okay, there's my legitimacy. Or, you know, sometimes I'm traveling, and in certain areas of North America, there's Buddhist colonies, right? And they come to my shows, different ones do. And I get a lot of flack because I'm rough and tough and I don't care, you know? And they'll say to me, I know what you're doing. Some Buddhist guy will say to me, I know what you're doing. I know what you're doing. Really good for you, good for you. And I go, oh, that guy gets it. That guy gets it. Really nice, you know? Those are the biggest things for me. I'm not interested in being a rock star or all that stuff. I'm 60 years old, you know? I don't care about that stuff. But quality of life, and, you know, if I can give people a better quality of life. I have this beautiful life. I travel all over the world playing songs. People tell me how much they love me. How can that not be the most beautiful thing? I'm sober. I don't do drugs. You know what I mean? I have my beautiful wife. We just drive around and play music. And we get to play edgy music. You know, it's not like we're playing Muskrat Love. You know, we're doing this thing. We're doing this thing. And it's just like, and I get to do this. And so I'm always interested in if I could help people with their happiness. You know, with their happiness. So that's the best thing.
Thank you all so much. We'll see you another time.
our trains wrecked and our buses fell apart. We couldn't see past the lights. We drove into the dark. We tore those places down. We burned them to the ground. And then we left those towns, headed down the road again. And my hands hurt from playing my guitar. Every night in all those bars, we play like we were stars. They backed us in a corner. The crowd called out for more. We turn it up too loud, play our way out the front door. Corey played the drums, and Willie played the mandolin. He jumped around the stage. We thought that it would never end, and my hands hurt from playing my guitar. Every night in all those bars, we played like we were stars. One more time, ladies and gentlemen, from High Hill, Texas, the fabulous Miss Tiff Jen. Thank you very much.